Well, let me put that aside and turn to another threat to survival, and not immediate, but imminent, and you're all aware of it. It's environmental catastrophe. The facts are familiar to anyone who bothers to read scientific journals, and each one is more alarming than the last one. So take a couple of very recent reports. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration gave its latest report on ocean surface temperatures off the northeast US coast. They're the highest in 150 years. Drastic effects on ecosystems keep going up. A couple of weeks before that, Science Magazine, you know, the main scientific weekly, reported, I'll quote, a study that showed that even slighter, warmer temperatures, which are less than what's anticipated in the coming years, could start melting permafrost, mainly in Siberia, which in turn will trigger the release of huge amounts of greenhouse gases, methane, much worse than carbon dioxide, that are trapped in the ice. And that'll set off escalating, you know, nonlinear processes of destruction. Geologists and archaeologists are now considering establishment of a new geological era. You know, history's broken up into geological eras. The new eras they're discussing is what they're calling the Anthropocene, starting with the Industrial Revolution, which is having huge effects on the Earth. The preceding era, the Holocene, begins around 11,000 years ago, with simultaneous about the time of the rise of agriculture. And the age before that, the Pleistocene, lasted 2.5 million years. You take a look at the acceleration, and that gives an indication of the fate towards which we're careening. Meanwhile, research papers in the Journal of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, you know, super respectable, report, I'll quote, 109 countries have enacted some form of policy regarding renewable power, and 118 countries have set targets for renewable energy. In contrast, one country, the United States, has not adopted any consistent and stable set of policies at the national level to foster the use of renewable energy. Now, that's not because of public opinion. Public opinion strongly supports measures to deal with a looming crisis. US public opinion is not very far from other parts of the world. And that's kind of interesting because, as I'm sure you know, there's been a massive corporate offensive here to convince the, for years, to convince the public that either there's no global warming at all, or if there is, we don't have anything to do with it, no human contribution. Now, that offensive is now escalating, accelerating right now in interesting ways because of fears in the corporate sector that the public is just too infected by scientific rationality. And that's as big a threat as, you know, a deterrent. An interesting program being initiated by a group you may know of, ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Council. No, sounds innocuous. It's a corporate-funded group that proposes legislation for state legislatures. You can imagine what they propose. And they got plenty of clout, given the wealth and power behind them, so a lot of these get accepted. There's a new one that's just being started. It's for K to 12, kindergarten to 12th grade education programs. They're trying to convince state legislatures that they should introduce what they call balanced teaching to develop critical thinking. That sounds good. What's balanced teaching? That means, along with teaching what's called climate science, you should teach climate change denial to kindergartners and all the way up. Then they'll have critical thinking and we'll be better off. And there are a couple of states that have already adopted it, and we can expect a lot more like this. Well, this aside, and imagine what a future historian, assuming that there is one, and it's not obvious that there will be, But suppose there's a future historian who looks back at what's happening right before our eyes, looks back at the early 21st century. Well, for the first time in history, humans are facing quite significant prospects of severe calamity, maybe destruction of the possibilities of decent survival as a result of actions of theirs. And it's not secret, facts are before our eyes, and despite the efforts of the corporate sector to conceal them, most people see them. And there's a range of reactions around the world. At one extreme, there are some who are trying to act decisively to prevent possible catastrophe. At the other extreme, policies are designed to enhance the threat, while the most powerful domestic actors are undertaking major efforts to deny what's happening and to dumb down the population so they won't interfere with short-term profits. Leading the effort to intensify the likely disaster is the richest and most powerful country in world history, with incomparable advantages, along with Canada, which is in many ways even worse. We're leading the effort. Leading the effort to preserve conditions in which our immediate descendants might have a decent life are the so-called primitive societies, First Nations, tribal societies, indigenous societies, aboriginal societies. That's going on all over the world. In the Western Hemisphere, for example, the countries with large indigenous populations, Bolivia and Ecuador, are pursuing efforts to introduce what they call rights of nature. We've got to protect rights of nature. Ecuador is in, they have big indigenous populations, a majority in Bolivia. They are proposing, Ecuador is an oil producer, but they're seeking aid, financial aid, from the rich countries so that they can keep the oil underground where it's supposed to be, okay? That's the backward primitive societies. And meanwhile, here we're racing with total enthusiasm towards quick disaster. Every time Obama or anyone else talks about 100 years of energy independence, you know, as if it meant anything, what they're saying is, let's destroy the world as fast as we can. So suppose we get every drop of hydrocarbons out by fracking and tar sands and anything else you can think of. What's the world going to look like? Well, you know, not our concern. Well, that's the concern of primitive, backward people who have these sentimental ideas about rights of nature. Well, that's what a future historian will see, if there is one.